السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما والحقنا بعبادك الصالحين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. إن شاء الله today we try to take three hadith inshallah. Hadith number 20, 21, 22 in Arba'in or now inshallah. Start with the one, first one. Hadith number 20.
Yeah, hadith number 20. An Abi Mas'udin, Uqbah ibn Amri, Ansari,
Al-Badri.
رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن مما أدرك الناس من كلام
النبوة الأولى
إذا لم تستحي فاصنع ما شئت. رواه البخاري.
Again, start with the first sentence. قال رسول الله.
قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن مما أدرك الناس من كلام النبوة الأولى.
Okay. This hadith just like short sentence, but the meaning is very nice. Of course, anything Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم say is very useful. Whatever he says is very useful. And we put Jawama al-Kalim. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him Jawama al-Kalim. Jawama al-Kalim means his words, he can give like a few words and the meaning is so powerful. Like hadith, la darara wa la darara. How many words now I mentioned? La darara wa la darara. La darara wa la darara. Words, right? To explain this hadith, especially by Fuqaha, of course, at least you need 2,000 pages. That's at least, actually. 2,000 pages to explain four words from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this hadith, إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَفَعَلْ فَاصْنَعْ مَا شِئْتْ. Very short words. But this lifestyle. So the explanation, you take it for all your life. You can imagine this explanation of this hadith, you take it for all of your life. Lifestyle. This is a few words, lifestyle. The way here is إن لم تستحي or إذا لم تستحي. إذا لم تستحي فافعل ما شئت. إن ما أدرك الناس إن مما أدرك الناس من كلام النبوة الأولى. الحياة is something since سيدنا آدم عليه السلام until سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم until the day of judgment. For all prophethood, like all prophets, give the same teaching for this. Because you know, Islam is one of course, but Sharia is changing. Like for example, Bani Israel, one of the rules happened to them when they made big sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their tawbah is to kill themselves. This Sharia. For us, you are not allowed to kill yourself for any reason. This one, this Sharia, like doesn't have any nasakh. Nasakh means like to be stopped and we exchange with another Sharia. No, this al-ayat. Always from since Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam until Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كلام النبوة الأولى. إذا لم تستحي فافعل ما شئت. This sentence has two meanings. You can understand this sentence by two ways, not one way. First way. إذا لم تستحي فافعل ما شئت. The first meaning. It says that if you try to do something or say something, If you really think that this thing not shameful, you don't feel shame if you do it in front of the people and Allah has seen you, then okay, do it, no problem. This is the first meaning actually. Again, because we shall go for next hadith directly. Just give you the main point of the hadith. إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَفَعَلْ مَا شِئْتْ. It has two ways to understand the hadith. Not one way. Two ways to understand the hadith. And this also gives you a hint why our fuqaha not in one mazhab. Why we have mazhab Ahnaf, mazhab Malikiyya, Al-Shafi'iyya, and Hanabila. With the same hadith, you can understand it by different ways. It's Arabic. Arabic is not giving just one meaning. So this like this hadith, it's more simple. إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَفَعَلْ مَا شِئْتْ. Wallahi, yes, it's giving us two ways of to understand, not one way. That's why we can't have one mazhab. It's impossible. Impossible. إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَفَعَلْ مَا شِئْتْ. The first meaning. If whatever you are doing is not considered as a shameful thing, and of course not haram, like you don't feel shy or you don't feel shame to do that thing, then do it. It will be mubah. Normal, general rule. The second way to understand the hadith, and this is the most famous. This is the most famous one, and the scholars take the second way to understand the hadith. Even though they also put this first way and the immediate in the box. So I'm giving you the two ways. Second way, إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَعِي فَفَعَلْ مَا شِئْتْ means if you don't fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you don't feel shameful from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you are doing something, do whatever you do, the judgment is there. That's the point? So the hadith giving you two different ways to understand it. Like one in the west and one in the east. Again, إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَفَعَلْ مَا شِئْتْ. First way, Omar, how to understand in the first time, first way. If you want to do something and you are really sure that this thing is not shameful. So, for example, I want to drink this water in front of you. Is it shameful? No, it's normal. So I can do it. This is the first way of the meaning of the hadith. The first way to understand the hadith. Not something shameful, okay, do it, no problem, mubah. But the second way is the most famous among ulama. If you don't obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and don't feel shame that you are making sin and going against his like commandments, even from the people, you don't even feel like shameful from the people. Like someone, for example, a'udhu billahi, just I need to give this example to people who will understand directly. If someone outside in front of everyone, in front of everyone, in Muslim country, can he kiss girl in front of everyone? By haram way, of course. Can he do it? Can he? Of course no. But if he don't even feel shame to do that and he do that in front of the people, what you can see for that person? He already like breaks the rules and break even the normal manners, like even people who are doing haram, they are hiding themselves, right? But they don't even care about the people. You do that in front of everyone. So that kind of people, إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي, if you don't feel shame from everyone, okay. Whatever you are doing, nothing can stop you. But remember, there is a day of judgment. So it's not to tell someone that what you are doing is allowed, no. It's threatening him. Threatening him. If really you don't feel shame from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and from the people, okay, do whatever you do, يَعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ, like the verse, يَعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ. It's not about to do whatever you want, no. So whatever you are doing, there is حساب. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of the hadith by second way to understand. Any question about this? I think it's clear, inshallah, right?
Yeah, for example, you mentioned if I want to bring water right now, you feel that it's okay, Allah allows us to
yeah.
In front of everyone. Mm. If some, for example, girls feels that it's shame, let's drink it like you know, secretly, you know, to maybe I will do some, you know, when I drinking somebody maybe look for me in other ways, you know, stuff. You know. In this case, she thinks that it's better to, you know, hide and then drink. Or in
no,
this
no.
case,
the haya of this point is not different. That. No, different.
Different.
Same as English, shy and shame.
Okay.
To the different. So the haya of that, not the mic. Can you stop? I think this one here, if you can see. Yeah, maybe. I hope it works. Yeah, it's just one, but I hope it works. Okay, where is this one? So, as we mentioned, shy and shame. So, al-haya itself, sometimes, for example, if my sheikh is here, I can't drink in front of him. I feel shy, not shame, shy, out of respect. But shame is another thing. Okay, so إذا أنت تستحي is not mean you feel shy, you feel shame, because it's a haram thing, it's bad thing. This is the meaning of the hadith. Any question? Fine. Next hadith 21. Bismillah.
One more question.
Okay.
For example, you know, lot of men, right? They don't feel shame when, for example, they're dancing.
Yeah.
How about these kids?
Okay.
They are like considering that they are doing, you know, okay stuff, but in Islam it's not okay to dance. Or how to understand that?
This thing, like man dancing, you know, especially that kind of dancing of like imitating the Western dancing and these things is against the nature of the man. You know, so if women, like women alone, you know, women alone, like women in separate room, in their houses, alone, no man sees them, they can do that kind of dancing, no problem. Because women, it's okay for them. Of course, if there's no man can see anything, of course. But man dancing, and by the way you are mentioning, is against the nature of the man itself, as Allah created him. But there is something allowed and something haram. Okay? Like for example, Sayyidina Ja'far radiallahu anhu, the cousin of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day he took bishara from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because of his happiness, he started to, like, you know, jump on one leg, you know, because he was very happy. So we can't say it's dancing, of course. What we mean dancing by this you are mentioning is literally a man are imitating women in dancing. This is big haram, of course. So it's up to what they are doing, because something, you know, considered to the culture, some, they are maybe like jumping or, you know, so it's not considered as dancing, but dancing, the real name of dancing, maybe the by Western way or women way or whatever, of course it's not allowed in our Sharia, and if some person do it by this way, of course it's halal. But if they are doing by out of culture and it's something in the whole country, no problem for them, like it's not related to women or Western country, whatever, just like expressing their happiness, for example, and just jumping or do some step by their legs or whatever. In this case, if out of the culture, all the culture in the country, even the scholars there who understand the background of this point, they say is allowed, then is allowed. But there is something common. We know that that kind of dancing is kind of dancing of women. If men do that, also it is haram, of course. And shabu bin nisa, which is crazy. So it's up to the mas'ala. It's not like one, we have one opinion about it, and some judgment must be like this. Get my point? Yeah. Clear, inshallah? Okay. Next.
And Abi Umarin wa Kila Abi Amrata Sufyan ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu qal qultu ya Rasulullah
sallallahu
alayhi wa sallam qul li fil Islam ni qawlan qawlan أسأل
قولا كل في الإسلام قول لا أسأل
قول لا أسأل عنه
but you asked or not كل في الإسلام قولا right
yeah and then لا
كل في الإسلام قولا لا yes
قولا لا أسأل عنه أحدا غيرك قال قل آمنت بالله ثم استقيم رواه مسلم
رواه مسلم so the first hadith reported by Imam Bukhari, this one by Imam Muslim. Okay. This hadith also is a very short sentence, and the scholars in the comment they say is this is from Jamal al-Kalim. Jamal al-Kalim means few words, but the meaning is huge. One Sahabi came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say, Ya Rasulullah, say to me something. I don't need to ask anyone else about it. Something clear, I don't even need any explanation except from your side. Like, no any explanation, just clear thing. Not something difficult for my understanding, just clear thing so I can understand it. Okay, that's the point? Because Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah gave him Jawami al-Kalim. So he gave us a few words, but of course it needs explanation. Much explanation, because it's Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he's speaking something, we need to explain years to explain his ahadith, of course, until our life finish and the hadith will not finish. So that Sahabi, he asked for wasiyya, for advice from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about Islam to follow it. But in the same time, I don't need to ask anyone else to explain to me. Like, I need something from your side. Something clear. I understand now. I implement it now. Then he said what? قُلْ أَمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَفْقِمْ قُلْ أَمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ If I put it to you in a like, simple words, is to renew your iman by your tongue and by your heart. Renew your iman by your tongue and by your heart. Clear? Clear. ثم استقم. استقامة, if also we put it in a simple way, to follow whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us, and to stay away from whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like say, this is prohibited. To follow whatever Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us, and to stay away from whatever Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, stay away from it. Istiqamah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. So this hadith also according to like this verse. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. قُلْ آمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. Yeah. So istiqamah is very beautiful meaning. And not everyone can implement al-istiqamah. We say in Surah Al-Fatiha what? اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. So we try our best to avoid whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said is prohibited and to do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us. This is a very simple way about al-istiqamah. Al-istiqamah, when you come to pray 5 times a day in masjid in the time, not delay. Of course, if you don't have excuse, all of us, sometimes I think secrets. Even me, even you, anyone. Sometimes it's great for the prayer sometimes, because you have excuse, yes. But if there is no excuse, then even you should come to the masjid before the time. So you pray sunnah, you pray tahiyat al-masjid, you know, make zikr, recite Quran, you know, to be prepared to perform the fard. Okay, this is istiqamah. Istiqamah, you know, whatever to do, whatever Allah commanded you, under this, you need to explain the whole Sharia. You got the point? It's just, you know, one sentence. To do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you. Under this was, under this every obligation. Plus sunnah. You got the point? So it's a huge word. So do istiqamah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you, whatever Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us, and stay away from whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this is haram or political or even doubtful. This in conclusion. Any question about that? Easy. Next. 23. 22. This needs some exhibition actually. This one next.
من أبي عبد الله جابر بن عبد الله الأنصاري رضي الله عنهما أن رجلا سأل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال أرأيت إذا صليت المكتوبات وصم رمضان وأحللت الحلال وحرمت الحرام ولم أزد على ذلك شيئا أدخل الجنة؟ قال نعم رواه مسلم.
رواه مسلم. Okay. So today we have one hadith from Imam al-Bukhari رضي الله عنه and two hadiths from Imam Muslim رضي الله عنهما. By the way, about Imam al-Bukhari, just one thing I teach you about it. The scrolls of Ahadith said, لولا الإمام أحمد رضي الله عنه لما جاء البخاري وما راح. So one of the teachers of Imam al-Bukhari is So what does that mean? Without the knowledge of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Bukhari will not be this Imam, huge Imam. And لولا الإمام البخاري لما جاء مسلم وما راح. Without the knowledge of Imam al-Bukhari رضي الله عنه, Imam Muslim will not be Imam Muslim. You understand? This ilm, from one to one, from one to one, like snow. This connection. This snow comes from this person to that person, to that person, to that person. Not to jump. No? Not to jump and say, I took that kind of ahadith or ahkam by my own. No, no, it's more. More coming from this scholar to that student. The student becomes scholar and give to, you know, like this. And of course, Imam Muhammad also has many like teachers. And his teachers, they got other teachers. You know, like until Abu Tabi'in, Sahaba, and Sayyidina Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just a small information for you. Again, start with Sunnah.
أن رجلا سأل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال أرأيت إذا صليت المكتوبات وصمت رمضان؟
Stop. One person came to Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And actually, if the people try to understand this by themselves, they will be in dalala, in misguidance. Wallahi, misguidance. And they will misguide the people if they understand by their own. Explain this hadith. A person come to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ara'ayta?
Iza sallaytul
maktubat. If I pray the five times prayers every day. وصمتُ and I fasting Ramadan. Continue. وأحللت الحلال. Whatever Allah سبحانه وتعالى said is halal, I believe in it. No problem. And وحرمت الحرام means whatever Allah سبحانه وتعالى said is haram, I avoid it. Then ولم أزد على ذلك. Continue. What he said?
أدخل
الجنة. If I didn't do anything more, I would enter paradise. Huh? What is the answer? قال نعم. قال yes. This hadith is talking by this way, by the understanding of the people, by their souls, with those exception of the scholars, it would be misguidance. The person came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked him these questions. You know why Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said yes? This person was a new converted. New converted, not powerful Muslim. This is the key of the hadith. This is the key of this hadith. So that kind of advice or that kind of answer is not suitable for me or you. This kind of answer was suitable for that kind of people. Someone just converted to Islam is still like zero. You need to learn. So you ask, what should I do? If you say, you have to do like this and this and this and this and this and this and this, say, oh, no need Islam, no need someone, right? But if you say, okay, you can start with the basics, pillars. When you are performing that kind of pillars, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you tawfiq to perform the sunnah. But if from the beginning, the person want to enter Islam or he just took shahada and he need to learn, say, you must do like this. And after that, you must do like this. And then this, and then you make it complicated for the person, say, oh my God, why even enter this religion? I don't need it, it's very difficult, it's very tough for me. Why? Because he didn't taste the beauty of Iman, which pushing the person to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do his best. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خاطبوا الناس على قدر عقولهم. Speak with the people according to their mentality. Not to make everything complicated for the people. That's why we repeat again and again, not everyone are allowed to understand hadith by himself or verse by himself. Why? Because if you take literal meaning means you don't need even to pray sunnah, you don't need to even recite Quran, you don't need to learn Sharia, you don't need to do anything, just do whatever mentioned in the hadith, go Jannah. Really. Is it what we are doing? Then why are you reading Quran? Why are you learning now 1 year already explaining Al-Arba'in al-Nawawi? Why? Right? Why I spent all my time to learn Al-Azhar if it's just easy like this? So this answer is very suitable for the person who asks about Islam or just converted. He need to learn. So give him the basics. When he do that kind of basics, automatically it will lead him to the Sunnah. It will lead him to learn more about Islam, to learn about Aqidah and Fiqh and the Hadith and Tafsir and. Not to make it complicated for the person. So, the point when he say, وحلم الحلال, read this one.
وأحللت
الحلال. أحللت الحلال, if the people took it literally, it means he himself will decide that this is halal and this is halal and this is halal. But this is not the meaning. This is not the meaning. The meaning is whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decided that this thing is permissible, he say, I believe. But if you take it literally, like those people, how it will be? Halal means what? He, I will decide. This is halal. No, this is haram. This is bid'ah. Oh my God. Okay? Well?
وحرمت
وحرمت الحرام also is not literal meaning. It's not literal meaning. حرمت الحرام means he decide that this thing is haram and this is like. So is this person either he will be أعوذ بالله God or prophet? Right? Who decide to say this haram and this halal? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? And from the Quran and Sunnah, the fuqaha took the ahkam istinbat. Ah yes, this thing is halal and this thing haram according to this Quran and according to this Sunnah, right? So if we took it by this way, the person as the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the time of Sayyidina Muhammad, like during the Sharia is still, established. Sharia of Islam. You say أحللت الحلال وحرمت الحرام. If it literally, if the person will take it literally and he will understand this hadith by himself, how it will be? He himself will decide this halal, this halal, this haram, this haram, this haram. It's not like that. Haram to haram means whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that this thing is prohibited, he would avoid it, he would not do it. This is the meaning of haram to haram. Clear? Adkhul al-Jannah. I continue with haram to haram, what is next?
وَلَمْ أَزِبْ عَلَى ذَلِكَ شَيْئًا أَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ قَالْنَا.
If I don't do anything more, I will enter paradise. The answer is yes. These two things about this point, as I mentioned. First, that person was newly converted. Not like old Muslim, like became Muslim like 5 or 10 years ago. No, just converted. He asked to learn. He wants to enter paradise. He asked, what is the way to enter paradise? If I do these things, I will enter paradise? He said yes. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by his tawfiq, when you start to do ta'at, he will give you tawfiq to do more and more and more ta'at. Same when the person fall in ma'asiyah, sin after sin, and he obey shaitan, أعوذ بالله شيطان will drag him to do more and more and more and more and more. So the more the person are doing good deeds, it will increase more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him tawfiq to do more. The more the person are falling in sins, shaitan will give him more and more waswasa and he will fall in more and more sins. So what does that mean? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he gives the sahabi that answer, he says yes, he makes things simple for him according to his situation. So when he will start to learn about Islam and do these things, it will lead him to do more and more and learn about Quran. And when he learns about Quran, he also learns the hadith of his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he learns the hadith of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will also then this sunnah, I have to pray sunnah, there is Quran I have to recite, there is ilm I have to learn, there is sadaqah, there is like this. Get the point? So it's just the gate. Yes, this is the gate, do it. When you enter this gate, the world will be wide for him. This is the first thing. Second thing, as I mentioned before in my khutbah and my class before, the hadith mentioned even Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim. لن يدخل أحدكم الجنة عمله. قالوا ولا أنت يا رسول الله؟ قال ولا أنا إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمته. سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم said, no anyone, his عمل, his deeds will make him enter paradise. They say, okay, maybe like Sahaba only. Even you, يا رسول الله, the best creation in this universe, even you, he said, even me. إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمته. Unless if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept me by his mercy. What does that mean? These things we are doing, this kind of five pillars of Islam, learning, Sunnah, reciting Quran and all of these things because we are servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is حق العبودية. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, mankind, and created jinn for what? To worship Him. This is our duty. It's not about to say, Ya Allah, I worship you, give me jinn now. It's not like that. As we are servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are obliged to worship Him. It's a separate mas'ala. Entering paradise is only up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not us. So don't think that if you do that kind of deeds, you will enter paradise because of you, because you did that and you deserve. This, you know, the word deserve. No, you don't deserve. Why? I give example in my last khutbah. I just read again for you to understand what I want. This cup, without even the water, how much for it in Japan here? 10 yen?
Maybe less.
Maybe less than this. 10 yen, okay, 10 yen. Assume that there is some very poor person, but his dignity is very high. So he never asks someone to please give me money. He put like some table like this and put cups for sale, like anyone can please buy from him, okay? It's equal 10 yen. Ashraf and you came to buy from him. He's a very poor person, but his dignity is very high. You don't ask for any money. So you put it from him by each money, 10,000 yen. 10,000 yen is out of your generosity, of course. Because you understand his situation, that he's a very poor person, but in the same time, he is not like we call shahat in Arabic. He is not so you say, give me, no. Is by his dignity is very high. He tried to sell something and do his best. But out of your generosity, you decided to give him 10,000 yen for something equal 10 yen. This situation is out of your generosity, right? But if that person, okay, this type, he said, Jazakallah khairan, and he was very happy for me, whatever he did, and finished. Let's assume another person did the same, he also sell same quality of cup, and Ashraf bought it from him by 10,000 yen. But that person said, I deserve the 10,000 yen because I sold him this one. Does it make sense? No. Why? Because the real value for this is just 10,000 yen. 10 yen. But out of your generosity, you give him what? 10,000 yen. This is almost what I want to say. Whatever you are doing, ibadah, hajj, and all of these things, it not even equal 1 yen. When you compare it with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave it to you. Compare that with the name of vision, basar. How many years you need to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give Him shukr for it? 500 years. It's just one name. One. And those 500 years is not like when you are coming to the mosque and Allahu Akbar. I will do something in my job. I think I have to check my bank account. I have to fix a problem with my friend. Alhamdulillah, this problem also. That kind of prayer, you know, it's not acceptable. You know, it would be acceptable as fard, of course, but the reward is down. Yeah? Not that. 500 years of accepted worshipping. If we will calculate by ourselves, we will judge ourselves. Now I'm 51. Omar, 50?
51.
Ashraf? 23? 23. So if me and Omar will say, okay, let's calculate our deeds by the years, how many years it's acceptable. If I speak by myself, I say maybe 1 week, among 31 years, even if it's acceptable, Allah Ta'ala. If I will be honest, maybe 1 week, acceptable? Because whenever we are doing something, our mind is, you know, here and there, especially when I'm praying. Right? But I'm speaking about 500 years of accepted worship. This is just for what? For your vision. So, how we will interpretize? We will interpretize if we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do our best to make Him satisfied. How to make Allah satisfied? To worship Him. Because it's our duty. Right? When we are worshipping Him, we are worshipping Him because we are His servant and He's our creator. Not because 10,000 yen equal 10,000 yen. No. No. We are worshipping Him. What? Because we are His servant. Right? Not to say, I sold this which equal 10 yen for 10,000 yen, I deserve 10,000 yen. No, 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 no. Don't go out of your limits. Why? Because some people, unfortunately, Bazar Omar, some people now dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by business relation. I did Hajj, then you must forgive all my sins. By this way, I give sadaqah, then you must multiply my money. Must. I pray, I make shahada, I give zakah, I'm making fasting, hajj, then you must give me paradise. Must. Is a price for what I did. Is that really the meaning of being servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you think that really what you are doing make you deserve Jannah? Really? It's not. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that yes, those people who are doing their good deeds, the best, they are in the paradise. So what's the connection between that and what I'm saying and the hadith? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that no one will enter by his deeds. What is the link between this and this? In just small word. We are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He commanded us to make Him satisfied. And if He becomes satisfied, we will be qualified to receive His mercy. And if we receive His mercy, we enter paradise. Here, we are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He commanded us. We try our best to make Him satisfied. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala became satisfied, we will be qualified, not deserve. No, no, no. You know, when you say that person is a candidate, is qualified to be candidate for this position, qualified. Not deserve, candidate, not a person who he takes his position by himself. No, no, no. Just to be qualified, candidate, qualified to receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you received it, then you enter paradise. This is the meaning of the hadith. Not by the literal meaning, and all of this, I just pray 5 times a day and fasting, give zakah. Make Hajj one time, go to sleep, alhamdulillah, Jannah in my pocket. No, what will be in your pocket? Who? Wallahi, no one knows if you will enter paradise or not. Not me, not you, not anyone here. No one can know that he enters paradise or not. It's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to really cover us by His mercy. Because if He did with us by His justice, all of us will be in hellfire. By justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of us will be in hellfire. You can't, you know, You understand what I mean by yourself. How many times we did sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How many times he give us ni'am, food, drink, safety, good weather, breath every second. Good family, good job. Give us everything. And what is our response? Sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if this dunya mean anything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even a wing of miscreant, he will not even give small cup of water to the kafir. لو أن الدنيا تعدل عند الله جناح بعوضة ما سقى منها كافرا شربة ماء. If this dunya means anything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even like wing of miscreant, he will not give even one from the cup to kafir, because he's not worshipping him. What about us? Taking this all of this ni'mah, and he gives us the biggest honor to be Muslims and his slaves, and we are making sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we say, I deserve Jannah. By who? By what? By what? So, big difference if you are dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are his servant, and you are worshipping him because you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from your heart, so you try to your best to make him satisfied. Of course, all of us hope to enter paradise. All of us escape from hellfire. All of us. And of all of us, making dua, Ya Allah, please, like, give us paradise. Ya Allah, please protect us from hellfire. But I'm speaking about the intention and how to deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while you are worshipping Him. You say, I deserve it. It's mine. I already put it. Like, you know, if you have a house, you know, car, you have a car. I bought your car. I pay money and I wrote in the contract that it's now it's mine. By the law, is it your car anymore? No, it's mine. Why? Because I pay money for you. Right? This is the same dealing. If the people deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this the price of Jannah what? Do this kind of things. Okay, I did it. Now it's my Jannah. Is it like that? It's not like that. It's not like that. Now, meaning is clear, inshallah. Any question? Okay. Subhanaka Allahu wa hamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.